Okay, so let's pick up from where we left off yesterday. So what I did yesterday was introduce you to the concepts of macroscopic thermalization and microscopic thermalization. Okay, I didn't say very much about microscopic thermalization, I'll do that today. But I did tell you a little bit about macroscopic thermalization. So macroscopic thermalization means that you start from some initial state, an initial density in phase space. Oh, from this one here? Okay, fine. All right. Okay, so this is some initial density. And then you let the system evolve according to its Hamiltonian dynamics. And then after a time t, you have this density, which, as we argued in the last class from Liouville's theorem, is going to be that. Okay, anyway, so that is the density. And then after you waited a sufficiently long amount of time, you start looking at the expectation values of macroscopic observables. And I still haven't defined what I mean by macroscopic, over what length scale these have to be macroscopic. I'll do that more specifically in the quantum context day after tomorrow. But for the time being, just ignore that little detail. So then you have, you can define, after a certain amount of time t, you can start calculating these macroscopic averages. And so macroscopic thermalization, which I called MATE, implies that in the long time limit, again, as I said, long times here being times larger than some accessible time scale, something like for a typical system, something like a diffusive time scale, where the time taken for a disturbance to diffuse across the system, assuming that the system thermalizes and there is a diffusion constant. Okay, so this goes to what you would expect, what you would get from the microcanonical ensemble. Okay, so FMC is defined as where rho microcanonical is nothing but the volume of the constant energy surface. Okay? All right. So this is macroscopic thermalization, but then as we were discussing in the tutorial yesterday, that this limit is something which has to be dealt with a little bit of subtlety, but one has to be a little careful about what this limit means. So in particular, imagine that you adopt the individualist point of view, which means that you're saying that the initial density is not really a density, it's a delta function, that your isolated system starts out in one precise microstate and then evolves. And then, of course, we discussed how thermalization would occur in that scenario, with that point of view, that there'd be one typical ensemble which would occupy the overwhelmingly large volume of phase space. And what would happen is that this point that you start out with would eventually, within some reasonable amount of time, reach this equilibrium cell, the cell which has the overwhelming volume of the equal energy surface, and then essentially for the remainder of the time up to infinity stay there. But essentially is the operative word in that sentence. And the reason that one has to say essentially is, as we were discussing in the tutorial, that if you have a system with a finite number of degrees of freedom, okay, and which is in some bounded region, then there is a theorem by Poincaré which says that no matter what initial state you start out in, after a certain amount of time, you will come arbitrarily close to that state. So what that means in this picture is that if you started with at some initial phase point, which was not in this typical ensemble, it goes into the typical ensemble, but eventually it makes an excursion out of the typical ensemble to come arbitrarily close to where it started out from. Okay? So what we have to ensure in order to make sense of this limit is that these excursions are very rare. Okay? That for the most part, except for maybe exponentially, except for instances of time which are exponentially small in something, and we see what that something is soon, this point, once it is in this equilibrium cell, remains in the equilibrium cell. That these excursions are very rare. So one way in which you can actually state that mathematically is to look at the deviation of this quantity from this quantity averaged over time. So basically calculate something like a standard deviation. So think of just think of this as being a list of f's for at different instance of time. So you get a list, you get a column vector of these f's, and you ask what is the variance of that column vector. The mean of that column vector is going to be this, but how much does it deviate from this? Okay, and we want those deviations to be small. So then you can quantify this by looking at a quantity sigma f squared, which is limit t going to infinity, 1 over t, and then integral 0 to t, ft minus f microcanonical squared dt. Okay, so that's nothing but the variance. You could also look at its square root, which would be the standard deviation. And if you can ensure that this quantity is small in some sense, and what we'll see in concrete examples that we look at is that this quantity will end up being exponentially small in the number of degrees of freedom that you have in the system. Okay, so again, I'll do that specifically in the context of quantum systems. But if that is true, then you know that in the thermodynamic limit, as the number of degrees of freedom becomes very large, this quantity is going to be small. And so that tells you that these excursions out of the equilibrium cell are going to be rare, are going to be few and far between. Okay. All right. So this is mate. Okay. This is what we mean by macroscopic thermalization. Microscopic thermalization has to do with the thermalization of subsystems. Okay. So this is the entire isolated system that we're looking at. Okay. So this is not some region in phase space. Now just think of this as, I didn't really draw it to look very much like a box, but think of this as the system that we started out with as our model system, which is particles in a box, classical particles in a box. So say that this is the box. And then you can look at a subsystem inside the box, which is some region of the box. And you can ask the following question. Does this subsystem look thermal? Does it look like it's in equilibrium? If you're given some state of the entire system, the whole system. Okay? So microscopic thermalization has to do with the thermalization of subsystems. Now, subsystems in the most general sense of the word do not have to be subsystems of the sort that I've drawn here. They don't have to necessarily be subsystems with the subsystems in real space. You can think of subsystems being, for instance, some subset of the total number of degrees of freedom. So let's say you've got n particles, n classical particles, and because these are classical particles, I can think of them as being distinguishable, and let's say I label them, and a subsystem could be some m of these particles. I could look at the state of m of these particles, and that could define a subsystem. Alternatively, I could have a subsystem like this. I could have some combination of different kinds of subsystems to make up some other subsystem. So there are many different ways in which I can define a subsystem. Okay? But for the majority of the remainder of my lecture series, when I'm talking about subsystems, I will be thinking of subsystems in real space. Okay? Now, why is that? So the reason for that is that when we get down to looking at concrete models, the model Hamiltonians that we look at are those which will have short-range interactions in real space, because those in some sense are the physical systems which we can make in laboratories, in cold atoms laboratories, and do experiments on. You know, those kinds of experiments have really, in some sense, inspired a revival of this field. So those are the kinds of Hamiltonians that we'll be typically interested in. Hamiltonians in which you have basically interactions or hoppings in real space, and which are compact in real space. And hence, for those Hamiltonians, it makes sense, especially from the point of view of experiments, for instance, to think of subsystems in real space. But what I want to alert you to is the fact that when you talk about subsystems in the in the most general form, they don't have to be confined to subsystems like this. Okay? All right. So then the question is, so microscopic thermalization has to do with the thermalization of subsystems, and subsystems which can be arbitrarily small in size. Okay, so that is one thing which contrasts the concept of microscopic thermalization with macroscopic thermalization. Macroscopic thermalization, there's some notion of these observables being macroscopic, okay? Being defined over some, over say a scale which is larger than some length scale. Whereas here, with microscopic thermalization, what we're really talking about is the thermalization of subsystems which can, in principle, be arbitrarily small. So, mite, which is microscopic thermalization, has to do with the thermalization of arbitrarily small subsystems. And you see, when we discuss concrete quantum models, for instance, spin models, that so the models that we'll be looking at will be something where you have spins on a lattice. Okay, and when we discuss mite in those systems, we will consider subsystems that can be as small as one single spin. Right? So really arbitrarily small subsystems. So this is what we mean by mite. And as again, as I'll show you in lecture 4, if this happens, if you have thermalization of arbitrarily small subsystems, then this actually implies macroscopic thermalization, because the subsystem, there's in some sense no bound on how large it can be, and it can get to be larger than the length scale over which you're defining these macroscopic operators. So if you're allowing subsystems of all length scales to thermalize, then this was also going to happen. But the reverse is not true. And an example of the reverse not being true is what we discussed in the last lecture, which is that if your rho of x, if your initial density was really a delta function, if you started the system out in one single microstate and let it evolve, then clearly there is no notion of this kind of thermalization for a classical system. Because at every subsequent instant of time, you know exactly what the microstate of the entire system is, and the subsystem is going to be some subset of the degrees of freedom of the entire system. So if you know what the state of the entire system is, you know exactly at every other instant of time what the state of any subsystem is. Okay? You will not get a distribution for a subsystem. You will not get a density for a subsystem which will look anything like a thermal density. So that is an example of a system where this kind of thermalization can happen, but that kind of thermalization doesn't happen. So it doesn't work the other way. So I'm really here thinking of subsystems in real space for the reasons that I told you a little while earlier. But yes, it could in principle be something which is as small as a single degree of freedom. Okay. Okay. So I'm going to write that down. I still haven't written. So this I've defined. Okay. I still haven't defined what this means what might is in a mathematical sense. I'll do that in just a second. Okay. But for that, I need to first tell you how you can get distributions for subsystems if you know what the distribution function is for for the entire system, which is what I was going to do next. And then after doing that, I will give you a precise mathematical definition of this. So anyway, so subsystems I can get a distribution function for the subsystem if I have a distribution function for the whole system in the following way. Okay? So the most general way in which I can do it is, so let me say that there's now a row S distribution function for the subsystem, which is a function of these phase space points, these microstates, the microstates which belong to the subsystem now. And so I can, in the greatest, in the most general form, write this in the following way, that this is going to be some, let me use a different symbol, G where rho of x is the density for the entire system. So you take the density for the entire system, okay, and then you multiply it by some appropriate kernel, a mathematical kernel, which is a function of x and x prime. X prime is a variable that goes here. And then you integrate over x. Okay? And that gives you this. So to take a concrete example, okay, suppose your subsystem was some subset. So again, you know, let's think of the system as being a collection of classical particles, n classical particles. And let's say that the subsystem was m of those n particles. So I labeled m particles out of these n and chosen them to be my subsystem. Okay. So if I do that, then the way you would obtain rho s x prime from rho of x is by saying that this kernel function is going to be product of these delta functions. So I labels the particles now, okay? And so this is the position, so this is the phase space variable. Okay, so remember that, you know, I've been labeling the microstates by this label x, but x is something which is really a collection of, in three dimensions, 6n numbers. Okay, it's not one single number. It's a set of 6n numbers. So the xi's are the elements of that set. Okay, so a particular, an xi for a particular I is basically the collection of the position coordinates and the momentum coordinates for the ith part. All right? So then, if you have g of x, which looks like this, this kernel function which looks like this, and you stick it, yeah. Okay, so I don't know if I used I to mean that in the last lecture. Here I'm talking, so I labels particles. So I'm giving you an example here, just to illustrate what this formula is, of a situation where the subsystem for this classical system is basically some subset of the total number of particles. Okay? And I'm choosing m of these particles, m less than n, some m particles which I've picked out, those will now comprise my subsystem. Okay? And I want a density function for that subsystem, only for those m particles. So then I take the density function that I have for all n particles, multiplied by an appropriate kernel, which in this case is this product of delta functions. Okay? And that is going to give me the density function for this particular subsystem. All right. So now you can see that, excuse me, what this in effect is, so if I actually take this and substitute it here, so this is really going to be an integral over all the other particles, okay? Because remember this dx, so the dx here, you think, you know, this volume element that I've written is really dx1, dx2, going up to dxn, right? So if I stick this delta function in here, that is equivalent to integrating over all the other n minus m particles and fixing the values of x for these m particles to be equal to xi prime. Okay, is that clear to everyone? Right? So you're basically integrating over those degrees of freedom which are not in your subsystem to get the density for the subsystem. Okay, so I would actually suggest that you just stick this in here and see what happens. Okay, and you'll see that what this amounts to doing, when you stick this in here to get that, what that amounts to doing is integrating over the remaining n minus m degrees of freedom, okay, while holding the values of the m degrees of freedom which you've defined to be your subsystem at these values, xi prime. Okay, so just stick this in, do it, and you'll see that that's right, exactly. And so dx1 itself would be d cubed r1 d cubed p. Okay, so this is just shorthand notation, because you know if I had to write all of this out, it would just span the entire board. Okay. So the reason that I chose this particular example, even though I said that you know subsystems that we'll be interested in are subsystems in real space, is that it's easy to see how you can get this how you can get a distribution for a subsystem with this example. And it also illustrates this other concept, which will be very important when we look at quantum systems, which is integrating over those degrees of freedom which do not reside in the subsystem. So to get a distribution for the subsystem, you integrate over those degrees of freedom which are not in the subsystem. For a quantum mechanical system, as we'll see later in this lecture, integrating over those degrees of freedom is what's called taking a partial trace. Okay, so we will we'll see that this, the equivalent of doing this integral for a quantum system, is taking a trace over the degrees of freedom of the entire system, and then integrating over the remaining degrees of freedom here is like taking a partial trace only over those degrees of freedom. So this is also to illustrate that, you know, that's something which is important and will keep showing up in the quantum context. Okay. Any questions? Yeah. Okay, so this is the kind of procedure that you would employ to derive the canonical ensemble from the microcanonical ensemble, provided this thing that was sitting here was the microcanonical density. See, right now I haven't specified what this density is. So no matter what the density is, you can always define this. It so happens that when you take that density to be the microcanonical density and then choose a subsystem in such a way that you can partition the energy of the whole thing between this and this, okay? And then you need one more thing, and we'll see this in just a little bit. In order to get the canonical distribution for the subsystem, there's another very important step, which is that you have to take the size of the rest of the system to infinity. So when you do, so the starting point is this, but then there are these additional steps that are required to get the canonical distribution for the subsystem starting from this. Okay. Yeah. A particle in a box. Okay. So are you, all right. So there, the thing is that if you have just a single degree of freedom, okay, as we discussed yesterday, so if you have this one particle in a box, then A, there is really, you know, at least, you know, there's no sensible notion of subsystems there. And as far as being in mate is concerned, okay, so it's going to be ergodic, right, as we discussed yesterday. And so it's going to be ergodic, but it is not going to be in mate, because mate requires chaos, okay? So when you have a Hamiltonian system with just one degree of freedom and conserved energy, like in a particle in a box, that is not going to thermalize. Okay, it's going to, so this is something which we discussed yesterday, and okay, so we only discussed the part that this was ergodic yesterday. What we didn't get down to discussing, but it's in your first problem set, is that even though it's ergodic, it doesn't thermalize. Okay, so any other questions? No. Okay, fine. All right. So. All right, so now that I've defined how you can get this, So let me now define what I mean by microscopic thermalization. So the definition of mite is this, that, so you can now look at a subsystem and you can look at its density distribution, there's its distribution function as a function of time. Okay, so you have some distribution function for the whole system, which is changing as a function of time. And from that, you can obtain the density function for the subsystem as a function of time. Okay, and you can look at what happens to this in the limit that t goes to infinity. And excuse me, in the limit that s bar goes to infinity, and what is s bar? So s bar is everything else. Okay, so s union s bar is the whole system. So if this is equal to trace over S bar of rho microcanonical. Okay. So I have a microcanonical distribution for a microcanonical density for the whole system. And then I identify a subsystem. Okay. So subsystem plus the rest of the system, from which from now on I'm going to call the bath. Subsystem plus the bath is the whole system. I let the bath, the size of the bath, go to infinity. Okay? And I let time go to infinity. Now there's a subtlety here about how you take these limits. Okay? So which I can discuss during a tutorial. It turns out that you really should be taking these limits together. If you take one of them before the other, then you either end up with Poincaré recurrences, or you basically end up, if you take the size of the bath to infinity first, then you set your diffusive time scale off to infinity, and then there's no time which is going to be sufficiently larger than that, so that the system thermalizes. So what you really need to do is you really need to take both of these to infinity in some particular way, okay, which we can talk about more in the tutorial. So if this is equal to this quantity, okay, that is my definition of microscopic thermalization, or mite, okay? And this is really what I'm going to refer to as thermalization from now on. So thermalization for me is thermalization of subsystems. So I'm asking, if I have an isolated system, does that isolated system act as a thermal bath or a reservoir for its subsystems? If it does, then I say that that system thermalizes, and if it doesn't, then I say it doesn't thermalize. Okay? And the reason that I've chosen this definition, which is now sort of the standard accepted definition in this field, is that this is a stronger definition than the other one. If this happens, that happens. But it's not true the other way around. Okay? Now, the reason, so I should mention that these kinds of issues are not new. All right? These things go back to Gibbs and Boltzmann and the founding fathers of statistical mechanics. But the reason that these issues have come back sort of with a vengeance now is because of looking at them in quantum systems and being able to do experiments now, as we discussed yesterday in the tutorial, where the full system is almost perfectly isolated. So you can actually test notions of isolation and its consequences experimentally, which wasn't possible earlier. So that's one reason that these have come back into focus. But the other reason that these have come back into focus is that a class of systems have now been identified which do not thermalize according to this strong sense either. Okay? Which do not thermalize according to the sense of microscopic thermalization. And these are these so-called many-body localized systems, which we'll talk about in the last lecture. Right. Yes, I'm doing that. So here, of course, you know, I've just written rho s of t, But you can ask, where did that rho s of t come from? So rho s of t here is basically trace over trace s bar rho of t, and rho of t starts from some rho naught. Exactly. But if it's, but if your rho zero was a delta function, then rho of t is always going to be a delta function, and this is also going to be a delta function, and then this can never be equal to that. And so this is just a statement that a classical isolated system start, you know, in the individualist point of view, will not thermalize according to this definition of thermalization. Okay. So I should also acknowledge, I should mention the names of the people who have brought these notions sort of back into focus in a quantum context. So this is, you know, this is basically from a couple of papers by Goldstein, Hughes, Leibowitz, and Tumulka, who have, you know, really sort of gone back and re-examined all of this, and especially in the context of quantum systems, which is what we'll be doing from now on. Okay. All right. So maybe this, the thing which you asked about the derivation of the canonical ensemble from the microcanonical ensemble, how it follows from there. So let's just defer that to a tutorial, because, you know, it's a reasonably standard thing which you find in textbooks. But there's no harm in going over it again, but let's not do that during the lecture. Let's just do it during a tutorial. So, yes, okay, so the thing is that if you say that this happens for arbitrarily small subsystems, okay, so then what you're saying is that, you know, let's say you've identified some subsystem which has a certain size, but you could do better. You could have chosen a subsystem which was even smaller than that, and that should also thermalize. And that new subsystem is going to be a subsystem of the older one. And then you can choose a subsystem of that newer subsystem, which is going to be even smaller, and keep going down all the way. Right? So the important thing here, the important thing here is that I want this to happen. This is a pretty strong statement. I want it to happen for subsystems of arbitrarily small sizes. So therefore, if you choose some subsystem which is not arbitrarily small, you can do better and choose a subsystem of this subsystem, which is going to be even smaller for which this will happen. So it's, I guess, who was that, Burton Russell, who said, describing something, it's turtles all the way down, so this is turtles all the way down. Okay. So anyway, all right, so this essentially concludes what I have to say about classical systems. And I will keep coming back to classical systems to compare and contrast them with quantum systems, but for no other purpose as such. So let's just look at quantum systems now. Okay, now how far can I go here? You want me to go back to that part of the board? Or can you see if I write a little bit on this side? Okay, so before I embark on describing quantum statistical thermalization in quantum systems, let me say, as I mentioned even in the previous lecture, the main fundamental difference is, unlike for a classical system, for a quantum system, an isolated quantum system in a single microstate, microstate to be defined soon, can actually thermalize in this strong sense of thermalization. So in some sense, quantum systems thermalize more strongly fundamentally than classical systems do. And so that's something which I will show you and describe over the course of the next few lectures. But in order to do that, let's just quickly look at quantum systems and try to understand what features of quantum systems we need in order to address the issue of thermalization in them. Okay? So by a quantum system, I mean something now where there is a notion of a Hilbert space of states. Okay, so there are degrees of freedom in this, which make up a Hilbert space. There's a notion of states in that Hilbert space, okay, which can be described in terms of abstract state kets. I'm assuming that everyone here is familiar with the bra-ket notation of quantum mechanics. So states are described by Ketz, and the definition of the system is that the system has a Hamiltonian, okay, which is defined, which is an operator on the same Hilbert space in which the Ketz exist. And the Ketz obey this equation, which is nothing but the Schrodinger equation. Okay, so that is what I mean by a quantum system. It's just a system where you have a Hilbert space, you have state Ketz, you have a Hamiltonian, and you have this equation of motion for the state Ketz, which is the Schrodinger equation. And I'm also going to restrict myself to situations where H is time independent, just like in the classical case, okay? So that energy is a conserved quantity here as well, just like it was in the classical system, okay? So now, the first question is, if you want to do statistical mechanics for a quantum system, for a general quantum system which is described in this way, for a general isolated quantum system that is described in this way, what is the setting in which you will do this? So what is the equivalent of a phase space for this quantum system? So now here there's a fundamental problem, which is that if we now again think of our quantum system like the classical system that we started out looking at, which is basically a gas of particles in a box, and these particles have position and momentum, there is a fundamental problem with defining a phase space and microstates for the quantum system in the way we define them for the classical system. Because of the uncertainty principle, for any given particle, you can't simultaneously precisely know its position and its momentum in some direction. Okay? So therefore, writing down microstates of the form that we wrote down for the classical system is simply not possible. Okay? Now, there are different ways out of this which have been proposed, where you still try to retain the picture of a phase space like you do for a classical system in terms of position and momentum, and define an effective density in that phase space, something like that, even though you have the uncertainty relation. So this actually goes back to Eugene Wigner and Hermann Weyl. So there's something called the Wigner-Weyl formulation of quantum mechanics for particles, which actually does this. But that's not what we're going to do here, because the Wigner-Weyl formulation, it turns out, becomes a little difficult to implement when your degrees of freedom are things other than moving particles. Okay? So when you have things like spins or other, or other exotic degrees of freedom on a lattice, it turns out that that is difficult to implement. So we are actually going to use a different approach in terms of defining a phase space for a quantum system. So this goes back to von Neumann. So von Neumann's suggestion was that a phase space for a quantum system is nothing but its Hilbert space. Okay? So whatever role the phase space was playing for a classical system, the Hilbert space does that for the quantum system. And why is the Hilbert space something which can replace a classical phase space? And that's because if you go back to the classical phase space and ask what is every microstate in that phase space actually telling you about the system, so every microstate in that phase space is a different state that the system can be in. And similarly here, all of these state Kets are also different, distinct states that this quantum system can be in, okay? So then you can import that notion of what a phase space is, basically a collection of different states that the system can be in, to the quantum context, and it becomes a Hilbert space. Okay? And that was von Neumann's idea. So von Neumann, Hilbert space is equal to the phase space. Okay. And so let me go back to this part of the board now. So that's the first thing. But what makes this quantum phase space very distinct from the classical phase space, and which will have consequences in just a second, is that while these are each state ket, these different state kets correspond to distinct states of the quantum system, they're not independent in a mathematical sense. They are not linearly independent. There is a notion of expressing one of these states as a combination of the other states, which has no analog in for the classical system. Okay? And that's actually going to have consequences. And you know that, so that simply means that if you're looking at the Hilbert space of the system, then any state get. And so I'm assuming that all of you are familiar with terms like orthonormal basis, Hilbert space, normalization, and so on. And if this has to be a normalized state ket, we also know that this is equal to 1. Okay? So why is this important? This is important because if you insisted on thinking of a microstate here as a set of n numbers, okay, just like we did in the classical case, and you wanted to ask what could the n numbers be in this case? These, for instance, could be the n numbers. Right? So you pick a particular basis, fix that, and then look at every microstate of the system in that basis. And to express any microstate in that basis, you're going to need these complex numbers. And so the set of these complex numbers could be something that can label the microstate, just like you had momentum and position labels in the classical case. Okay, so that's one thing. Now, in a particular state, one can calculate the expectation value of a physical operator. Okay, so let's say A is a physical operator, is a Hermitian operator, and this is going to be summation over mn. Star Cn Amn, where Amn is this. Okay, again, something which you're familiar with. So in a particular state, you can calculate the values of these observables. Okay, so now we have everything that we need in order to define averages in phase space over these things. Okay. So now let's try to define the equivalent of a microcanonical ensemble for this quantum system. Okay? So for the classical system, the microcanonical ensemble corresponded to identifying a constant energy surface, looking at the microstates on that surface, and weighting them equally. That's the microcanonical ensemble. So here, of course, there's going to be a problem in the following sense. That unlike in the classical case, every microstate doesn't have a well-defined value of energy. Okay? The only ones which have a well-defined value of energy are the energy eigenstates. Okay? But this here is any general state. You can write it as a superposition of energy eigenstates, but this will in general not have a well-defined value of energy. So that is likely to complicate things. But the way around that is to say that the constant energy surface in quantum mechanics is going to be defined, so the constant energy surface the time, no, they could be time dependent. See, this is, so you take a particular state and that state can be expressed like this. Now, if that state, if you obtain that state by evolving from some other state, then that other state would have different coefficients, and the coefficients would evolve from one to the other to give you this state. Look, there's no notion of time dependence here. So I'm talking about, so these are a complete orthonormal set, okay? So you have a Hilbert space. See, time becomes important when you are defining dynamics. Time becomes important when I say that the size obey this equation. At this level of the discussion, I haven't even talked about what equation size the size obey. Okay? Let's say you forget about the Schrodinger equation. You just have the Hilbert space. In the Hilbert space, you can define states. Okay? And you have this notion of there being a basis for the Hilbert space, this complete orthonormal basis, and every state being expressible as a linear combination of these basis states. That's all I've written. Now, how things are going to evolve with time will depend on what dynamics these things obey, which in our case, of course, is Schrodinger dynamics. An orthonormal basis means that this is a delta function. It does not mean that this is going to be a delta function. This is just some observable, okay? And so if I take, in an orthonormal basis, if I take some random physical observable, some Hermitian operator, that is going to have some off-diagonal matrix element. This is all that is, okay? So the orthonormal condition is this. This is the orthonormal. But it doesn't say anything about that. Okay, fine. So constant energy surface here for us would be a set of states psi, which all have the same expectation value of the energy. Okay. These are not stationary states. Stationary state, okay, the difference between this and a stationary state is that if this were just some general state, something which looks like that, which is not an eigenstate of H, it can still, it still has an expectation value for H. I can calculate this, I'll get some E, okay? But if this is not an eigenstate of H, then what will happen is that if I calculate this quantity, this is not going to be equal to E squared, okay? And so there's going to be some uncertainty in the energy. Whereas if this is a stationary state, an eigenstate, then this is going to be equal to E squared. So there is no uncertainty in the energy. Okay, so these are not stationary states of H, okay? So this is how we can define a constant energy surface. But what's important here now is that we have to be mindful of fluctuations in energy of these microstates, a concept which was not there in classical mechanics. Classical mechanics, if you took a particular microstate, it had a well-defined value of energy. Here, this is not the case if you identify these with microstates, because they need not have a well-defined value of energy. What has a well-defined value of energy are the energy eigenstates, okay? All right. But so the constant energy surface is going to be defined this way. Yeah, they are the same. I mean, but energy eigenstates, wait. See, here, a stationary state is something which is not evolving as a function of time, okay? But in order to even say that something is stationary, you have to know what that time evolution is, right? For which you need the Schrodinger equation. But if I give you a Hilbert space, right, then the Hilbert space structure and how you're expressing a particular state in that Hilbert space or the linear superposition of basis states has nothing to do with any dynamics that those states will eventually have to satisfy, okay? So here in all of this, this is just, this is just linear algebra. I have a certain Hilbert space. I have a certain set of basis vectors. I'm saying that any other vector in that Hilbert space can be written as a linear superposition. And I'm not worrying about what sort of dynamical equation these things might obey. No, okay, so here so at this point, I need to say that this H is energy, okay? So up to this point, nothing depended on any notion of a Hamiltonian. But the moment I'm now, if I have to talk about a special surface in this Hilbert space, which is a surface of constant energy, I need to define what energy is. So now I need to bring in the Hamiltonian and say that the energy for a given state is nothing but its expectation value, the expectation value of the Hamiltonian. Okay, first of all, we're not yet interpreting states as ensembles, okay? So here what we're doing is we are saying that the Hilbert space is like the phase space. A state here is like a microstate, okay? Okay, so I'm coming to that. I'm going to show you what the microcanonical ensemble is in just a second, okay? Where the microcanonical ensemble here, how you get the microcanonical ensemble. So since you brought that up, I mean, that's what I was going to do next. So the microcanonical ensemble is basically something where in the classical case, you have microstates and you give them all the same weight. Okay, and the microstates lie on an energy surface. So let's do that in the most general way here. So let's assume that you have some Hilbert space, okay, some Hilbert space, and let's say that we are going to give all microstates in that Hilbert space the same weight, and microstates in that Hilbert space, the only constraint on them is this, right? That's the only constraint. So anything which has this constraint, any state which obeys this constraint, I'm going to give it the same weight, and if I do that, then what would the expectation value of some observable look like? Okay, so let's just do that and see what we get. Hilbert space. Equal weight. For all. Microstates. Okay. Which have so now what I want to do is, I want to now, in this ensemble, where I'm giving equal weights, some external equal probabilities to all microstates, ask what would be the expectation value of some operator A. Okay? So the expectation value for some okay, so first of all, now how do I calculate this? So the way I calculate this is the following, is let me just write this down, and I'll explain in a second what this means. What this means is the following, that C and C star here are basically these coefficients. So remember that these can be complex in general. They have a real part and an imaginary part. And the real and imaginary parts are in general independent, only subject to this constraint, okay? And so instead of thinking of the real and the imaginary parts as being independent, I can think of the C and C star as being independent. It's the same thing, okay? So what this is some probability distribution over the C's and the C stars, and all of these only subject to this constraint, okay? So basically I take a state, I express a state in terms of the n's through a set of these things, okay? And all these numbers are subject to this constraint, but otherwise there is no constraint. And I say that the way I'm going to weight all of these numbers is through some probability density, which is a function of the set of CC stars, okay? Set meaning the members of the set are all of these, C1, C1 star, C2, C2 star, and so on, okay? So I have that probability distribution. And then when I want to calculate the expectation value of some operator, I just take the expectation value of the operator in a given state, stick it in here, and then just weight it according to this probability distribution. And that gives me the expectation value of A for this probability distribution in the whole Hilbert space, okay? Now, in the microcanonical case, the thing which is equivalent to the microcanonical case, P of C comma C star is a constant, right? We are weighting all states equally. P of C and C star is a constant. Okay, I'm not yet doing it. I'll come to the constant. So right now, just think of it as a general Hilbert space. Now, whether that Hilbert, how that Hilbert space is spanned by energy eigenstates is something which I'll come to, because there's a slight subtlety there. Because of the fact that in a quantum system you have discrete levels, you don't really have the, very simply have the notion of a constant energy surface with a Hilbert space dimension, for any random matrix which is greater than one. So which is the reason I'm not doing, I'll come to that in just a minute. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying this, okay? Here's a sign. You first fix n. You fix your orthonormal basis. Any state in that orthonormal basis can be expressed like this, okay? Now what I'm saying is that for each of those states, I'm going to assign a probability, an a priori probability to each of those states, okay? And what is that, and how do I specify that a priori probability? I'm going to specify that a priori probability with this probability distribution. which means that if you give me a set of these C's for a particular state, looking at the distribution, I'll tell you what the probability is of the occurrence of that state. Right. So for any state, there's a set of C's. You give me a set of C's that specifies the state, and then from the probability distribution, this function, I can tell you what the probability is of the occurrence of that state. Okay. So this is, and now when I'm calculating A, not only do I have to calculate the expectation value of A in every state, I have to weight those expectation values by the appropriate probabilities. So that is just this here, okay? Now, what I'm going to say is that, excuse me, all right, with the constraint that CN squared is equal to 1, right? So if I give them all equal a priori probabilities, then you can convince yourselves that what this is going to be you really don't even need to convince yourselves, it's just writing the formula in a slightly different way. So this is going to be equal to summation n m cn star cm. Where this is the average of this quantity over the given distribution, right? And the distribution in question is one where these all have the same a priori probability, all right? So now let's just look at this thing a little geometrically now to see what this is going to be equal. So each state satisfies this constraint, right? So which means that I can actually think of these states geometrically as living on the surface of a 2n dimensional sphere where n is the dimension of this Hilbert space. Okay, so far I haven't said anything about the Hilbert space dimension. Now we need the dimension of the Hilbert space. So let's say that the Hilbert space dimension is n. So you can now think of each state as a point on the surface of a 2n dimensional sphere. So if you think about it that way, then I leave it as an exercise for you to argue the following thing, that if you look at the average value of something like this, these are just the coordinates now of points on that 2n dimensional sphere, that for this uniform distribution, so when P of CC star is a constant, CN star CM is just going to be equal to 1 over N delta NM. Okay? So if you don't see this immediately, I would urge you to try to work it out for yourselves. It's because of the fact that so each of the C's is a complex number, right? So it has a real part and an imaginary part. Any other questions? Okay. So please try to work this out for yourselves, all right? What this tells you now is that if you're looking at the expectation value of any A in this equal, in this ensemble where all states are equally weighted, this is going to be equal to trace of A by N. Okay. Does everyone see that? Where trace of A is defined as all right? Okay. So this is actually something that's interesting. So let me write this in a slightly different form now. and just tell you why this is interesting and how this sort of illustrates the importance of superposition, this result. So this I'm going to write as trace of rho times A, where rho, so A is an operator, rho is also now an operator, okay? So rho times A is an operator, and rho is equal to, okay, where I is the identity operator, the Hilbert space. So basically I is nothing but the identity matrix, if you like, whose elements are just these delta functions. You only have one along the diagonals and zero everywhere else. Okay. So this is what rho is. Okay. And so this rho is the density operator or the density matrix or matrix corresponding to is a constant. Okay. Now something interesting has happened here. So what's interesting, the interesting thing which has happened is that even though we started out looking at all the states in this Hilbert space and weighting them equally, finally, when we have to calculate the expectation value of any operator in this particular ensemble, it just boils down to taking the operator, multiplying it by this density operator, which depends only on the dimension of the Hilbert space, okay, and calculating its trace. Right? Or in other words, another way of looking at this is that this you just multiply it by some operator. And because it's an operator, it has a certain matrix representation in this orthonormal basis, which of course in this case is just the identity. It's the identity in any basis, okay? But what we've done is, we have in some sense removed the requirement of worrying about any of the other states, except for the basis states which span this Hilbert space, right? So even though we started out worrying about the individual size, in saying that all the individual size are being weighted equally, the final answer that we get is something which requires this operator, which has some representation in the Hilbert space, for which we only need to know the orthonormal basis states. Okay? And the n which appears down here is a dimension of the Hilbert space, or simply the number of these orthonormal basis states. No, rho is not. Rho right now is a density operator, okay, a density matrix, which tells you that, so remember we are assigning a priori external probabilities to all of these states, okay? So rho is the operator which tells you that all the states in this particular orthonormal basis, okay, have the same probability. Okay, so look, we haven't made any assumption, okay, the equal a priori probability assumption that we made is for all of these states, any all states psi, not just the orthonormal states, not just the basis states, all states psi have the same probability. But then in going through the calculation and seeing what that means for the expectation value of some operator, we come to the conclusion that we don't need to worry about all the states, we just need to know what the basis states are in order to express A in that basis, because, you know, A is a matrix. We need to express it in some basis, and that's our basis. So we need to know what the basis states are for this, and also for this, but then this it's simple. It's just the identity in any basis, okay? And we need to know the number of basis states that there are, which is just the Hilbert space dimension. So we don't need to worry about any of the other states in some sense, aside from the basis states. And that is something which has emerged from this, okay? And the reason that has happened here is that these microstates that we started out with, while they were physically distinct, were not independent of each other, okay? That, you know, and that's the structure of the Hilbert space, that's the structure of quantum mechanics, that these distinct states can be expressed as linear combinations of one another. So because we can do that, eventually for this ensemble, we can get rid of, you know, we don't need to worry about these individual states. We need to just focus on the basis and look at how many basis states there are. Okay? The basis, again, why do we need the basis? Because we need to express this operator in some basis. And any basis will do. There's no special basis. You can choose any basis, and this is going to work because we are taking a trace. Okay. So, right. So that will matter. You know, I've written a summation sign here as a catch-all thing for everything. Okay. Now, if your Hilbert space is something which doesn't have a discrete basis but a continuous basis, then you have to be careful about writing these sums. I mean, these are going to be integrals and with you know, delta function normalization conditions and so on. But as long as you're careful doing that, yes. Only thing, of course, is that, you know, you can still define this, but then writing this is a problem. The only constraint on the CNs and the CN stars, okay, remember that when I say CN, it's a set, right? There's a C1, C2, C3, C4 going all the way up to C capital N, where N is the Hilbert space dimension, okay? Now, you can choose these Cs to be whatever you like, okay? Which up to a global phase, which I didn't worry about here, and which up to a global phase, and as long as they satisfy this condition, are guaranteed to give you a distinct quantum state. You take a particular set of Cs, okay? They are going to give you some state. You take a different set of Cs, and as long as those are not related by some global phase, and as long as they're normalized, they're guaranteed to give you a distinct quantum state. And so the whole point of saying that this is a Hilbert space is that if you let the Cs be whatever they are, they can be up to these constraints, okay? Whatever they are up to these constraints, then the allowed set of Cs will give you all the distinct quantum states that you have. Nothing will be left out. That is what you mean by a Hilbert space being complete. I mean, they're different numbers. The only constraint, look, a C is C real plus IC imaginary, okay? These are real. Now, these are independent. When I say independent, again, remember that there's this normalization constraint. Aside from that, there's no constraint. No, that's why I can write the what, sorry? Okay, so are you wondering what this symbol means? Yes, so what this symbol means here is that when I write down something like this, this is shorthand for the set C1, C1 star, C2, C2 star. Okay, all right, fine. Right, so if you insisted on using C real and C imaginary instead of C and C star, everything would go through, okay? You would have C real and C imaginary here, you would have C real and C imaginary here. And because we are choosing this uniform density, if this P is a constant when you write it in terms of C and C star, it'll also be a constant when you write it in terms of C real and C imaginary. Okay? And this factor will also be the same because the Jacobian of this transformation going from C, C star to C real, C imaginary is equal to 1. Okay? So which is what I said earlier, that you can think, you know, the reason we're doing this is that soon, although I don't think I'll be able to get to it in this lecture, we're going to start doing Gaussian integrals, okay? And for the Gaussian integrals, then we're going to look at what are called different random matrix classes, where things can be real or complex. And in treating those random matrix classes in some uniform footing, it is going to be useful for us to work in terms of the variable C and C star, rather than the variable C real and C imaginary. And hence, I thought that I would do it right at this stage. But it doesn't matter here. Okay, so I haven't come to that yet. Okay, that's a good point. So far, I've been doing it for a general Hilbert space, okay? And I've said that this Hilbert space is spanned by some orthonormal vectors. I haven't said that those orthonormal vectors are eigenvectors of some Hamiltonian. I haven't come to that yet. Or eigenvectors of a Hamiltonian with eigenvalues within a certain range. So that's what I was going to come to next, if that is what you're worried about. Okay, so here, look, I have not yet, I haven't even talked about the microcanonical ensemble here yet, where I'm saying that I'm looking at a constant energy surface or an energy shell and weighting all the states with an expectation value equal to an energy within the shell with the same probability. I wrote this down just to tell you what it means for a state to have an energy quantum mechanically, but I haven't used any of that yet. Here I'm saying that there is a Hilbert space, okay? There's a Hilbert space which is spanned by a certain number of, which has a certain dimension, okay? I'm not worrying about any Hamiltonian defined on the Hilbert space yet. I've identified nothing specially as a Hamiltonian. There are operators, Hermitian operators on the Hilbert space, and I can meaningfully talk about the expectation value of a Hermitian operator in any state on the Hilbert space. I can meaningfully talk about the expectation value of the Hermitian operator over the entire Hilbert space once I have given you a priori probabilities for each of the states, okay? So that's all that I've done here. So I've said, so this tells you if you're given some a priori probability for each of the states, then what would the expectation value of some operator be in the Hilbert space, okay? And this is what it turns out to be, as if the a priori probability is the same for all states. That is what this is, okay? I have not anywhere said that the Hilbert space that you're looking at is something which is such that it corresponds to states with an energy within a particular shell for a given Hamiltonian. I haven't come to that yet. That is what I was going to do next. So this is just a general formalism to sort of show you that when you're calculating things like this with the same a priori probability, then finally it turns out that you don't need to worry about all the states, you just need a basis. You just need to know the operator in that basis, and that's it. And this is because, so what this is telling you is that you need, even though your Hilbert space has a whole number of states, you just need a very, very small number of states, which are the states in some basis, and expressing the operator in that basis, and that's it. That allows you to calculate this. You don't have to worry about any of the other states, okay? So this actually ties into something that's quite important that you do when you're doing statistical mechanics, but you sort of don't consciously think about it. So when you do quantum statistical mechanics, you have to calculate things like the density of states, okay, in order to calculate various quantities. And what is your definition of the density of states? So there you look at some energy window, and you're counting the number of states in that energy window. Okay? Now, what do you mean by counting the number of states in that energy window? So what you end up doing, finally, in most of these calculations is, you end up counting the number of eigenstates of the Hamiltonian in that energy window. Now, what's so special about the eigenstate? Because there are other states as well, which can have an expectation value of energy in that window, you might think that you'd need to count all of them. And this is something which tells you that you don't, right? Because finally, if you say that within that energy window, everything has the same probability, a priori, meaning the a priori probability depends only on the energy and nothing else, then you just have to worry about the eigenstates within that window, and not about the other states, okay? So this is something which you do all the time in these calculations, but this is a justification. All right, okay, fine, so, right, okay, good. So the fluctuations in the, right, okay, so I haven't come to that, so all right, so I haven't even talked about thermalization yet, or for a typical operator, or, Right. So if you, I think it would be, although, I'm just wondering if that would be true for any operator, including projection operators. Okay, we can, let's just discuss this offline. Okay, I think what you're saying is right, but, okay, all right. So, okay, so this, now, having done this, having established this, let's now look at the microcanonical ensemble. So the microcanonical ensemble is where we now have to worry about a constant energy. Okay, so this is not just any Hilbert space now. We are now going to look at some Hilbert space in which the states have some, some expectation value of energy. Now the thing is that if you wanted to just confine yourself to those states which have a single expectation value of energy, and not a spread of energies within some interval, and you did all of this, then eventually, of course, when you look at this, you'd come to the same conclusion, and n would be now the dimension of the Hilbert space, which would correspond to eigenstates having one particular value of energy, right? If you restricted that to be this one particular value of energy, that's what would happen. Now, if you take a random quantum Hamiltonian, by random I mean, you know, something which is not fine-tuned in any way, which doesn't have, you know, any, which doesn't have a lot of symmetries, just some very generic kind of quantum Hamiltonian, then the chance that you will have more than one eigenstate at a particular energy is, the probability is going to go to zero with the size of the Hamiltonian. Okay? And this is, if this is something which seems a little, you know, difficult to digest, we will do this in detail in the next lecture. I mean, this is going to be important for our discussion of random matrix theories. But that's what's going to happen. Repeat the statement. So the statement is this, that if you take a quantum Hamiltonian, if you take a Hamiltonian, which is not fine-tuned, okay, which means that it doesn't have values of parameters and some basis set to some very particular special values, or it doesn't have a lot of symmetries, so which means that it doesn't have a lot of other operators which commutes with it. And if you were to look at the spectrum of such a Hamiltonian, and if you were to look at the energy eigenvalues, then the probability that you would find two energy eigenvalues which are very, very close to each other, and, you know, which are very close to each other, is going to fall off exponentially with the size of the Hamiltonian, the size of the dimension of the Hilbert space on which the Hamiltonian is defined. Okay, so we'll do this in detail again in the next lecture. So what I'm trying to say is that for generic Hamiltonians, if you were to restrict yourself to just one energy, then you would typically just restrict yourself in this final thing to a dimension, or to a Hilbert space of dimension one. Okay, so if you want to have something which has some number of states in order for you to be able to do any statistical mechanics, then you would actually need a spread in energy. And but of course, having said that, I will convince you in the fourth lecture that we can actually do statistical mechanics even with one single state. Okay. In fact, that is the whole point. That is another one of the important takeaways from this lecture series. Yeah. No, I'm saying that you can do that, and then you can turn the crank, okay? But then finally, once you have done all of this, you will not have this n large if you, okay, I think the answer to your question, I take back what I said, that you can actually have that n large in the state that you're, in the situation that you're talking about. But what you will have is, you will also have appreciable uncertainties in the energy, and we don't want to look at states like that. Okay, I think that's probably, and I'll tell you why we don't want to look at states like that in the next lecture. Okay. Anyway, so you look at states within a particular window, and you do your statistical mechanics there. But the thing which I want to convince you of, and I will do in the fourth lecture, is that it is absolutely reasonable to do statistical mechanics or a quantum system with just one single state, with just one single eigenstate, okay? And that is something which underlies the basis of, you know, which basically underlies what's called the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, that a single energy eigenstate behaves like an ensemble. So here, when you have an energy spread, you're still thinking of some ensemble of the system with states within a certain energy window. But as we will see in the fourth lecture, that a single eigenstate is going to be good enough. But let's not worry about that for the time being. So typically, what you're going to do is you're going to choose some energy to lie between E and E plus delta. And then you're going to have some, you know, and this is going to be the dimension of the Hilbert space of energy eigenvalues, which will be in that range. Okay, fine. So now what we've done here is we've introduced in this, you know, in this calculation, this quantity rho, And rho is this identity operator in the Hilbert space for equal a priori probabilities, and which is basically the density operator corresponding to this probability distribution. So this density operator is the analog of the density function that we had on phase space for the classical system. Okay? So we can define a density operator more generally. So density operator or density matrix acts on some Hilbert space. And what is the definition of the density matrix? The definition of the density matrix is that it's something which looks like this. Okay. So these alphas are states in the Hilbert space. And these alpha, and the alphas here, are states in the Hilbert space which are distinct, but not necessarily orthogonal. Okay? And P alpha is the external probability, some externally imposed, some a priori probability, of finding the state in this particular, or finding the system in this particular state. Okay? So this is the density operator in general. In our case, in this calculation, we assumed that the P alpha was the same for all alphas, and the alphas which appear in the summation are all the states in the Hilbert space. Okay, and then once that happens, then our density operator assumes this particularly simple form. But in general, that doesn't have to be the case. This is a general form of a density operator or a density matrix with these probabilities, and these and because these are probabilities, they have to sum to one. Okay. So has everyone here seen a density operator or a density matrix in a quantum mechanics course? Because if you haven't, then it's going to be difficult for me to proceed with what I have to say after this. So in case you're not familiar with the concept of a density matrix or a density operator, I suggest that you look at some textbook on quantum mechanics and revise, and either learn about it or revise what you know about it, because it's only then that we can sort of proceed. Okay, so I have about 5 more minutes. All right, so I think I've gone through about 20% of what I wanted to do in this lecture. But anyway, so let me just tell you a few more things about the... Oh, you have a question? I know, it's okay, but that's fine. I mean, this was supposed to be a school, so it's good that there are many questions. All right. No, so that's what I said, right? So this is true in general. If I take states in a Hilbert space and assign them some a priori probabilities, okay, some external probabilities, I can define a density operator, which I can then multiply by operators in the sense of an operator multiplication, take the trace, and that will give me the expectation value of that operator in that particular ensemble. Now, in the particular case, where these p alphas were all equal and the states which appeared in the sum were all the states in the Hilbert space, then this assumes a particularly simple form, which is this. Okay? That's all. So that's the relation between this and this. But this is a more general form of a density matrix or a density operator. Okay, so, right. So now, the trace of rho is always equal to 1. You can prove that from that definition of rho. And the other thing, which is also, it was a problem in your first problem set, is that the eigenvalues of rho lie in this interval. So the eigenvalues of rho are, it's a Hermitian operator, you can also prove that, so they have to be real. And not only are they real, they're positive, and not only are they positive, they lie in this interval. Okay? So this is something that will be important, and you should prove this. Okay. So the density operator also has an equation of motion, okay, like the which you can derive from the Schrodinger equation, the fact that the individual states obey the Schrodinger equation. And the equation of motion for the density operator is this. Okay. And this tells you, or you can look, or you can even work it out otherwise, that rho of t, if you know the density operator at time 0, then the density operator at time t is going to be given by okay. And so this or this, you know, one follows from the other, is sometimes called the quantum Liouville equation. And this is completely analogous to, is analogous to the classical Liouville equation. This is the classical Liouville equation, and that's the quantum Liouville equation. Here you have the Poisson bracket, and here you have a commutator. So I hope everyone knows what this means. Okay. So the density operator obeys this equation. If your quantum system was in one single microstate, okay, so quantum system in a for a single microstate, which is also called a pure state, the density operator is just that. So for a single microstate psi, which is also called a pure state, the density matrix of the density operator is just this, okay? Which means that if you wanted to write this down in some basis, okay, it's an operator, you can write it down as a matrix in some basis, then there is a particularly convenient basis. That particularly convenient basis is the one in which this state itself is one of the basis states. And so in that basis, the density operator is going to look like this. It's going to be one entry with this one, everything else will be zero. Okay, which has to be contrasted with this, where the density operator in whichever basis you choose is just basically going to be 1 over n, 1 over n, 1 over n along the diagonals, and 0 everywhere. Okay? So these are, in some sense, two extremes of, you know, for the density operator. This is what you get for the density operator when there is a probability, an external probability of 1 for the system to be in a particular microstate and 0 to be in all other microstates. Whereas this is what you get when you have exactly the same probability for it to be in all microstates. And so these are two extreme limits. Okay. So let me just end by saying this and pointing you to a question in the problem set. So the two limits, so when I say these are two limits, you can actually quantify the two limits in terms of a quantity. And this is the von Neumann entropy. The von Neumann entropy is for a given density operator is defined to be that minus trace of rho log rho, okay? And what you can work out for yourselves is that if your density operator was for a pure state, then this is going to be equal to zero. And if it was, and if you look at the density operator for this state, okay, which is this equal probability state, then this is going to be equal to log n, where n is the dimension of the Hilbert space. Okay, so zero and log n, and these are the two extreme values of this operator S. So what you have in your problem set is to prove that these are the two extreme values, zero and log n, and that the highest value log n is something which you get when you have this. Meaning that don't assume this, okay? Figure out what the highest value of S is and figure out what rho is going to give you the highest value of S, okay? That is what you get for, you know, and show that this is the rho which will give you the largest value of S, okay? And so this is going to be important for us because when we start looking at subsystems, we are actually going to get a density operator for a subsystem by tracing out degrees of freedom, okay? Like I mentioned for the classical system, we'll do that for the quantum system. And how much of an ensemble the subsystem is in, okay? How mixed the state of the subsystem in is going to be characterized by a similar entropy, which is something that's called the entanglement entropy. So the amount of mixedness between the subsystem and the rest of the system is something that's called entanglement. And we will quantify the entanglement by this kind of entropy with a rho for the subsystem, which is the entanglement entropy. Okay. Thanks.